We're really blessed tonight. We've been blessed all day long to have a very special friend with us, Dennis Agajanian. And, you know, I'd mentioned this morning that when I gave my life to Christ at Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa in 1992, Dennis was one of the regular musicians, worship guests at Greg Laurie's Monday night. And I'm telling you, every time, when you drive to Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa, you listen to the radio, they would say who the guest artist would be. And my heart always leapt when I heard that it was going to be Dennis Agajanian. And, you know, he loves God. He's an amazing evangelist and preacher. He is an extraordinary musician. And just to watch him manhandle the guitar is absolutely amazing. We are really, really privileged tonight to have him. And so I'm blessed to be able to introduce him to you as my friend and brother in the Lord. Would you welcome, really give it up, solid style, Dennis Agajanian.
Like I'm in your living room playing. This is cool. Sound check, they had a stool over there, and I was just going to use a stool for maybe one or two songs with the 12 string, and I know I'm big, but I just touched it, and the whole thing went down. I went down with it, so I'm going to sit. See if I damaged anything. Let's give Mark a great round of applause, my sound man back there. Thank you. go preach it. Thus say, if you believe it, can't you be more outspoken for him? If you love him, tell your neighbors that he's the only savior. Thank you very much. How many people here like bluegrass music? Some of you, okay. Well, I'm going to do a bluegrass song for you. I raised in a real small church. And there are 35 people in the church. They were all senior citizens. So my brothers and I were the only youth department. And the only music department we had. So, and the pastor said, I don't care, you know, how you do the music, just don't change the words. And so we said, okay. So we really would wild things up, especially some of the old fast hymns that, but bluegrass is, this is kind of what bluegrass music is. Me to victory. filled for me in glory. Read about those streets of gold on the crystal sea. About the angels singing that old redemption story. Some sweet day I'll sing up songs of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me, then he bought me. I'll play a fast one for you. No, I won't. I really appreciate being able to be invited to this incredible church and be put up there at on the strip there. Sure, a lot of people drinking out there, you know. And it's amazing how bare it is early Sunday morning. So I was thinking of those people. Kind of country now. Come to the rock, build your life upon it. You will see a change after you've known it. He will give you life like you'd never. You don't have to get stoned anymore. Sound okay out there? Is my guitar too loud? I'll turn it down if it is. It's okay. Okay, how many people here like classical music? Oh my goodness. All right. I don't look the part, but you know where the Spirit of God is, there's liberty. So I'm gonna play some classical music for you. I always like to try challenges, you know, and I don't want to just be a guitar player and then kind of quit and do what I'm doing and just kind of stay with what I play. And Mozart is very hard to play. And so I want to do a little Mozart for you, Rondo alla Turca, we'll do that. A little bit of Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata, a little bit of Spanish stuff, you know, people that speak Spanish. How many people speak Spanish here? Mucho amor para ustedes. Dios te bendiga. All right. All Okay, a little Rondo a la Turca, back to Mozart. Here we go.
Thank you.
tell you what, that was fun. I hope they taped that. That was a lot of fun. And I lost a good friend 3 days ago. Man who's a good fisherman. Lives in Alaska and he works for Franklin Graham, my best friend. He was just known as George. All he would do is work and fish. He had this little Jack Russell dog, his best friend. About a month ago, the dog died, and George just went downhill after that. And so I would always sing songs about him. Kind of blues songs like this, kind of like street blues. This trip or something. Yeah. Well, man, hello, how are you? I'm in a church for the Lord, that's right. Building, working on building, working on building for my Lord, for my Lord. Working on building, this Holy Ghost building, working on building for my Lord. This how's you ending now. Calvin was my favorite uncle, and he was in the war, World War II, and they have these pictures on the wall. They're just black and white, you know, because it was just long ago. And also my other grandfather, Agajanian, had all these pictures, and my cousins are here. They live here in Las Vegas, and they gave me some pictures. My grandmother's Kardashian, and so she married my grandfather, and my grandfather said, I'll marry you, and she said, but you have to take my whole family, all my aunts and uncles and everybody, to America. So he did. He brought the whole Kardashian family over. And my cousin gave me these pictures of the Kardashian family, and all the way through, you know, the sisters and the brothers, and my grandmother and all her brothers and sisters. They were strong Christians. And I don't know what they'd be thinking now, but my cousins, I love them, and they need prayer. And a lot of prayer. My wife is close to the family, and she's... So I want to do this song about family, if you don't mind. I said, Grandpa, what's this picture here in black and white? It ain't real clear, is that you there? I said, yeah, I was 11. Said, times are tough back in 35. That's me and Uncle Joe trying to survive on a cotton farm in the Great Depression. If it looks like we were scared to death, like a couple of kids just trying to save each other, should have seen it in color. Now this one here's taken overseas in the middle of war, 1943 in the winter time. You can almost see my breath. That's my tail gunner, old Johnny McGee. He was a high school teacher from New Orleans. He had our backs until the day we left. Well, it looks like we were scared to death, like a couple of kids just trying to save each other. Should have seen it in color. A picture holds a thousand words, but you can't take away those shades of gray that cover. Should have seen it in color. This one here's taken overseas. Let's see. Now this one here's my favorite one. That's me and Grandma in the summer sun. She's all dressed up the day we said our vows. You couldn't tell it. It was hot that June. The roses red, her eyes were blue. Just look at that smile. I was so proud. If it looks like we were scared to death, like a couple of kids just trying to save each other, should have seen it in color. A picture holds a thousand words, but you can't take away those shades of gray that cover. Should have seen it in color. Jesus said that John the Baptist was the greatest man born of woman. John was born with the Holy Spirit, and Jesus Christ was born with the Holy Spirit. And of course, they were very close apart during their birth. And it wasn't about John. People were fascinated. Herod was fascinated by John the Baptist. In fact, he would come and he would see him preach. And scores of people, it said all of Judea and all of Samaria came to see him. He was like a rock star. Princes came, queens, and different people. His ministry only lasted maybe 18 months. But John, it was about the Messiah coming. Some people ask him if he was Elijah. And he said, I'm just a lonely voice in the wilderness crying out. And of course, there was a time when he heard of Jesus. But he thought, well, Jesus was witnessing people, and he would go in the bars and sit and eat with the publicans and sinners. And he heard that he'd talked to the woman at the well and different people that... And so he asked, go and ask, is he the Messiah? And Jesus said, you go tell John that the blind see and the lame walk. You know, here's a man that's so incredible. And we think of all the people in the Bible. There's none greater than John the Baptist. All his predecessors were never as great as John. And when you think of how great a man, you know, not many books are ever written about John the Baptist. When the boat reached the land, he stepped out on the sand. Then behind him stood the man of Galilee. Those who were sent by John, asking him, are you the one? The Baptist is in prison, he can't see. Well, the voice so loud and clear, Jesus spoke to those who'd hear. Go and tell John all you've seen and heard. Tell John the blind receive their sights. Tell John the deaf hear and the dead are raised. Good news has reached the poor. Go and tell John, don't wait around no more. Near death he could tell, well, the voice he heard outside in the sun. Looked up, he could see all the men of Galilee. With a smile he said, praise God, my work is done. Tell John the blind receive their sights. Crippled men they walk upright, and the people have been cured of leprosy. I was a friend of Johnny Cash's, and it was an honor to play with him several times on stage. I guess the biggest honor I'd ever had was I was invited to perform for Roy Rogers and Devil Evans at a big honoring them, and Billy Graham was there, and I've worked with Billy Graham since 1974, and but Roy Rogers and Dale Evans and Johnny Cash and June Carter and just a slew of people that were out of the old West, you know, and it was fun playing there. But I've always liked Mr. Cash. He's just such a gentleman. Last time I was with him, we were in Canada, and he sang "Happy Birthday" to me, and he started the rumor that I was a fast guitar player. I never said that about myself. He did. But I miss him so much, and he was just such a legend. And his music was very simple. It'd be only be in tune. Oh, here we go. If you went to Sunday school, you'll know this song. Why don't you sing it with me? Well, I've got a home in glory land that outshines the sun. I've got a home in glory land that outshines the sun. I've got a home in glory land that outshines the sun. Way beyond the blue. Well, do Lord, do Lord, do remember me. As my Savior, you take me. I took Jesus as my Savior, you take me. I took Jesus as my Savior, you take me to way beyond the blue. Well, do Lord, do Lord, do remember me. Do Lord, do Lord, do remember me. Sing it out. Try that one. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. You sing it now.
Say it.
Jesus is the way. Again, Jesus is the way. I just thank the Lord that I could play guitar. And coming over here, I wasn't going to tell y'all, but coming over here, we pulled out the hotel, and then we're on this trip heading towards Tropicana, and I'm on the right lane, and there's that, you know, fence, big metal fence that's there, separates the people from the cars. And I'm talking to my daughter on the phone, and we're going, we're trying to get this light that we're going to turn right on Tropicana and hit 15. And here are three guys beating up on a guy. I think they probably killed him. It was bad. And I'm in my truck, and I'm, how can I get over there? The car's behind me, and then I see a slew of people just watching, not doing anything. And they kicked him in the head, and the guy just laid there. And in all the people, I thought, and I turned right and felt kind of guilty of that. You know, why didn't I jump over there and grab one of them, beat the snot out of them? I could take one of them. I can't take two of them. I could whip most people my age. And those punks, you know, when they're punks like that, they don't know how to fight real good anyway. They kick you, and they bite and scratch, and they cheat like crazy. But it was just... The fence was there, this big bar fence, you know, and everybody, oh, well, man, nobody doing nothing. We're living in a decadent society. It's slowly decaying away. It's not getting better. It's getting worse. The Democrats don't have the answer. Before you start high-fiving each other, the Republicans don't have the answer, you know, and the independents don't have the answers. The only hope in this country is Jesus Christ. It's not like, oh, you have a little religion and you kind of believe that. You know, I had an aunt on my mom's side that would always say, well, all roads lead to God. And I finally told her, yeah, it's a judgment. Everybody's going to see God. All roads do lead there. But there's hope in Christ. There's nothing that will give you hope. When there's death like George dying, there's nothing there, but through Jesus Christ, he gives you hope. The world will not give you anything. Religion won't give you anything. It's through Jesus Christ, because you're created in his image, men and women. Genesis 1:27. He's the only hope. He's the only way. And you might say, well, won't you say he's pluralistic? No. Won't you say that he's inclusivistic? Absolutely not. He said, I'm the way, I'm the only truth, I'm the only life. No one comes to the Father but through me. He's exclusive to everything else. When you look at the scriptures, you look at its thesis, now and then think of the antithesis, the other side, and you see how pure the thesis is, how pure the Word of God is. There's only 66 books there. It's not very many books, but it gives you power. It gives you strength. It gives you forgiveness. Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship. And you could go to God, and you can, it's the only faith in the whole world, out of every religion, even that may look Christian, that's different. And this is how it's different. When you pray to God, he talks back to you. None of those statues out there talk to you. He may talk to you through the Word of God. You may open the Bible and the Lord speaks to you. You may be in your car and that voice back there, he talks to you. And he gives you peace. And when you accept him, there's peace. There's forgiveness. To be able to be forgiven of every sin you've ever thought about or done in your life. You know, I've never killed anybody. I've never used the Lord's name in vain. But you know, the sins that are in my life and every person's life, to think that you could be forgiven and then God has the power to forget your sin in Hebrews 10, Hebrews 12. To think that Jesus Christ, our Savior, runs the planetary heavens. This world is going 1,000 miles an hour in Hebrews 1, verse 1, 2, and 3. That God has appointed his Son, head of the planetary heavens. It's his power that keeps it going. It's the Lord's power that loves you. And it's the power of God to everyone that can believe. And how do you do it? Do you work your way? No. There's two religions in the world. There's a religion of human achievement. It all started in Babylon years ago, and it's still today. Every religion that you see has to do with works. It all has to do with achieving yourself and bettering yourself, and it's about you. And then there's a religion of divine accomplishment. For by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourself. It's a gift of God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. We don't work our way to God. If you try to obey the law, you're going to fail. But it's through the graciousness of God that he knows you and he loves you. He knows you by name. He knows every hair on your head. He knows everything about you. And he cares for you. And he's offered a way. Not by work or feeling guilty, you got to go do this and wear little badges and I'm a great person and I'm boastful. No. He's the antithesis of everything else. He's the great one. He's our King. He's our Lord. No means or measure can ever define his limitless love. I just thank God that he cares for you. He didn't create this earth just to appreciate it. Everything is about you. Everything is about you. Over the sun and the stars and the galaxies and the solar systems and everything else, there's nothing more important in the eyes of our Creator than you. And he had to come down himself in man. The pre-incarnate Christ during the Old Testament he came. And he stood with mankind. Then he came as a child. So you would believe. He made it easy. He made his Holy Spirit come down in fire. And when you believe, he comes in. How's that happen? The only thing in your whole life that doesn't age is your soul. Everything else ages. We're all getting old. I feel that chair. That picking chair, whoever made it, didn't know what they were doing. You might say, well, you weigh a lot. No, I barely touched the thing. I was down. We're getting old. But the soul lives forever. Your soul will not age. And God's Holy Spirit comes in. And when he comes in, he takes over your whole life. And he's there to offer comfort. And he says, trust me. All ye that are heavy laden, come unto me, I will give you rest. I will sup with you, and you with me. And you wake up in the morning, and you have a security. Some people take advantage of the security. Well, I'm a Christian. I'm secure, so I'll go sin. Shame on you. You don't want malaria, stay out of the area. It's not what a man says, it's what he is. You look at a person, and, hi, how are you? And you have not a clue how valuable you are to God. He didn't create the angels in his image. He didn't create animals in his image. And you want a personality of God. You want a character of God. Go to the Caribbean and go snorkeling. Look at those picking fish. God created everything. Everything. Everything that there is, he created. He made it. But more important, he made you. And he just wants to have your last breath on this earth, your first breath in heaven. He wants to be with you. He created mankind to have fellowship. He wants to talk to you. He wants to fellowship with you. He wants to sing with you. He wants you to praise him. And he'll take care of you. And it's kind of like in our family, the Agajanian family and Kardashian family, my cousins over here. You know, the older man take care of the family. In the house, somebody word comes to the door, I'm not going to have my wife go there. Some men would do that. Honey, go see who it is. No. I get up. I go. It's kind of like Marshall Dillon. A guy calls you outside, you go outside. It's just a thing that you do. You take care. But the Lord does that to you. Takes care of you. Looks out after you. And he loves you so much. I know some of you believe in Christ, but maybe you've never really committed your life to him. Maybe you've never really asked him into your life. Pastor couldn't have said it more eloquent this morning, saying, look, if you love me, it's like, if you love me, feed my sheep, be part of this church. Look at this place. Go up the street. I don't know, there's churches like this, a gym like that. You got services packed out over there. Thousands of people. And you got ministries everywhere. And it's a joy to come and to be part of the great work that's here. It's not about Dennis Agajanian. It's not about my music. It's about the work here. It's about you. You're the reason I'm here. It's just you. I'm not going to say try Christ. Listen to me. I want you to accept him tonight. Look at me. I want you to accept Christ tonight. You ask him in your life, and you ask him to forgive you of every sin you've ever done. Don't get into this, I'm not going to be religious. Forget that stuff. It's not a religion, it's a relationship. And he'll come in, and he'll forgive you, and he'll love you, and he'll never leave you, and he'll always be there, and you'll never see hell. You'll never see death. You may vapor lock on the ground. You're gone. You're instantly in heaven. And that body's going to join you later on. And you're who you are. You're alive and you have a living soul. No monkey has a soul. No horse has a soul or cute dogs. It's you. Well, I have a Yorkie. He might have a soul. He's so good. He's like a no-sin dog. He's like a Christian dog. And he just loves you, looks at you, doesn't get in anybody's way. He's 4 pounds. But God cares for you and he loves you. I want you to, right now, bow your head. Not that you're closer to God. I just want you to not be distracted. I want you to say a prayer after me. I want you to really mean this prayer. Usually I have people say it silently. I want you to say it out loud. You want to know that you're going to heaven when you die. You want to know that every sin you've ever done is forgiven right now and forgotten. It's wiped out of God's mind. It's in your memory because you happen to think about it. But God has forgotten about it if you accept him. And his son's blood cleanses you. Blood is life. The blood of God cleanses you. That's what happens. I want you to say this prayer. Say it out loud. I want you to say it loud too. Oh God, I need you. I'm sorry for my sins. I accept Jesus Christ into my life right now. Lord, I love you. Thank you for loving me. Help me to be strong, God. Help me to share your word. Help me to follow you always. Thank you for loving me. I love you. Lord, we thank you for these people. In Jesus' name, we thank you. How many people meant that? Lift your hand up. I usually count, but I'm not going to count. There's so many. I just thank God. Thank God for you. And usually guitar players, it's not good when they're speaking or preaching. Forgive me for being long, but I just love you guys. Appreciate you so much. wife and I will be driving back to San Diego, and then we'll get in about 2 in the morning. Then at 4 in the morning, we have to drive to the airport. We're flying to Austin, and we're going to do Decision America with Franklin Graham there. We're doing 40 of the state capitals. We go to the state capitol. He holds a prayer rally. I play. He speaks. We have thousands of people come. We have tens of thousands of people come. And then we'll get in a car. We'll drive to Oklahoma City, and the next day we'll do it there. And then that day we'll drive to Topeka, Kansas, and do it there. And then I'll fly home. The next day I'll go to Nome, Alaska. I'll be in Nome next weekend, and then home. But let me just say this. I don't usually say this. I know your pastor real well. You know, I get to meet people and pastors. But I know Greg Laurie wrote. I know the pastor here. You know, the Bible says that Barnabas was a good man. It also says that Enoch walked with God. Pastor Derek is a good man. He walks with God. This man's serious about God. He's serious about the Bible. He's serious about the Bible. And the man is a shepherd. Like among sheep. He's like a rock in the sand. You know, and he's there. And he looks like a coach or an athlete. And he looks you in the eye with those eyes. You know, and if you don't have a church, feel free to come here. Calvary Chapel, you don't join this church, you just come. They don't even take offerings, you just come. We have some CDs in the back if you want to help us in our ministry, that'd be great. Got 4 new ones, got an instrumental one, and songwriters, and Best Picks 3, and even a Christmas. You don't have to buy anything, but go back there if you want to help us some. But this church is a solid place. And I'm in churches all the time, but this place, if I'm lying, I better carry a lightning rod. I'm not going to lie to you. God has really blessed this place. This is a shining light in a dark world, and so I just thank God for it.